What a thrill for the computer to be able to do this because it can't do anything else. I'm able to get this taping program to work, and hopefully I can upload it to YouTube. But pretty much everything else on the computer isn't working anymore. I can't upload or download pictures from like Facebook at all, or from any site. Uploading, downloading pictures doesn't work anymore. The computer is basically grinding to a halt, or it's being blocked by the grace of God. It's probably being blocked. I tried to start this car we have here today. It wouldn't start, and then I was told, well, someone started yesterday. Said it started fine yesterday, and I tried it today. It said nothing. I said that's very weird. A lot of stuff is being blocked. I'm finding you might be experiencing this, and who knows? We may be going into another higher dimensional realm where electronics don't work. That would be nice, wouldn't it? It'd be great. That would be like hallelujah, and hopefully. You know, hopefully it doesn't cause any inconvenience to anyone. We're getting so habituated to electronics, we can't even imagine living without them. Isn't that amazing? But we used to live without electronics just very well. In fact, way better than we're living with them, actually. So it would be quite nice if we ascended in such a way that electronics just simply wouldn't work at all. The whole principle of electronics doesn't work there. That would be, I'm looking forward to that. That is for sure. What a pain electronics are, actually. I've never liked electronics. You basically have to use them now, but I met this woman in the market yesterday. She said, I don't have a computer. I don't have a cell phone. I refuse to use this nonsense. And it was pretty amazing. She also said she had 23 surgeries. And this, I took with this conversation, I said, I got to look up 23. I know it's, God wants me to focus on 23. That, you know, such, who comes up to you and says, I've had 23 surgeries? Okay, so I Googled 23. Comes up what? 23rd Psalm. So I go to the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He leadeth me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. And goes on about saying how God will take care of those who speak up for God. And it was amazing because I have been praying about the future, saying, how am I going to be taken care of? It seems to be almost impossible. But I was reassured by this amazing sequence that the Lord is my shepherd. Those who speak up for God, God is their shepherd, and you will not want. You will not want. In fact, you'll have wonderful, wonderful, beautiful green pastures and still water, so to speak. Exactly the kind of experiences you really love. So I took that in and have run with it with confidence. Last night I was also looking at a video. YouTube still works, at least as far as I know. I haven't tried it today, but everything's gone haywire. But it finally triggered in me. I'll tell you, I had an amazing experience where I came across this video of a radio interview with Dion DiMucci, the great American singer, songwriter, entertainer. And in that interview, Dion talks about his experience with God, experiencing God, and how he was in a terrible heroin addiction. And he tried to stop it, he couldn't. And he just said he felt completely hopeless, and there's just no way. His life was completely out of his hands. And he met somebody, and then someone said, well, you need to get down on your knees and ask God for help. And he said he didn't know anything about God or praying or anything like that. But he was so desperate, he decided to do it. And he just got down on his knees and asked God for help. And he felt something come over him, and like he was washed clean. And he said he stood up, and all desire for the life he'd been living, the heroin, the kind of life he'd been living, the habits, were gone. And he said they've never returned. They never returned. He hadn't had a drink or a drug for, like, I don't know, was it 48 years or 50 years, whatever, law, you know, just, He said it just vanished and never came back. That's quite a testimony. And he's gone on to be, you know, quite the man, quite the man. And anyway, so then I saw something, a video on the right side of YouTube with all these videos that are listed for you. Maybe you'd be interested in this one or this one. So I said, it said the Billy Graham Crusade in Southern California. I said, let me click on that. So I clicked on it, and I'm watching it. And they're revving the audience up as they always do for Billy by bringing in testimonies and stuff. But they started out with this Midwestern preacher, and how they have their style, you know, and talking to the audience and lowering the brightness just a little bit in this. And then he says, and ladies and gentlemen, talk about redemption. We want you to hear the next thing. And he says, and then he introduces this first guest of this huge revival in Angel Stadium in Anaheim. And I couldn't believe my ears. He said, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dion DiMucci. I said, what? I just finished listening to a radio interview of Dion DiMucci. And there is Dion on the stage talking about God and then singing a great song, I Threw My Idols Away, in front of all this crowd. I just said, what? I mean, what are the odds on that? That was quite extraordinary to experience that. But then I went on to listen to and something clicked in me, and I knew. I said, I've got it. I've always felt that there's something not quite right about the modern Christianity, okay? There's something isn't right about it. And finally, you know, I know what it is, but maybe I just can't say it, but I finally just said, ah, of course. Because of the Apex Yoga meditation I've been doing, our non-meditation practice, which has been extraordinary, I've gotten into deeper and deeper and deeper aspects of mental, you might say, trickery, seeing through it, experiencing it. It arises. And I just keep on saying, I am a apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. And stay in the now with that. And all these amazing styles of attempts to deceive ourselves arise. And so I'm aware of this now. So aware of it. And what I am aware of is that Christianity, especially like the modern Christianity, you might say, but let's say just, you know, the conservative movement and the liberal movement, okay? The two that are butting heads in the world right now that I'm telling people to stay neutral and stay out of this, okay? This is my message. Stay out of it. Be like Switzerland. Stay neutral. They're both trying to kill Jesus. They're both trying to kill Jesus, but they're using different pathways to try to do it, different styles. But really, I came very, very clearly aware that this revival, Billy Graham revival, they're trying to kill Jesus, okay? And because they're trying to kill his message. And Jesus was a messenger of God, okay? And they're doing everything they can to kill his true message, just as the liberals are trying to kill Jesus' message too, by you know, in their way. So really, you have two sides of the same coin. Two sides of the same coin. Both are trying to kill Jesus. As Jesus said, the body profiteth nothing. It's my message, my teaching is my bread. That's the bread of eternal life that I want you to eat. And they have just, you know, and I just saw how that's what they're up to, actually. In the name of Jesus, they're trying to kill Jesus. But I'm just like calm with it. Say, okay, yeah. Because I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Meaning, I'm accepting the fact where everything's apex. Right? It's all apex. That's Jesus' real message, actually. So, because I'm not trying to kill Jesus' message, I'm aware of those who are trying to kill it. Trying to kill Jesus by killing his message. And I get this feeling like, wait a minute, you know, whoa, 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 whoa. And it was very evident, very evident. But Dion's testimony about God was really something. He was like so naive. He said, I knew nothing about religion, nothing about God. He got it straight from God. And he ultimately quit, went back to Catholic Church now. He maybe, you know, maybe he got disaffected with Protestantism. He said, but the way he talked about God was very interesting. Very, very, very compelling. Where he has it in his heart somehow. He has it in his heart beyond all the religion. You know, he has something there. And I can feel it. I can feel it. I can tell that, you know, he's been graced by God in some way. Really has been in his life somehow. It is quite extraordinary. But continuity by fear, their bias against certainty distorts our perspective on God. Very much so. Very, very much so. And you don't really believe this until you experience that these areas of the mind, of thinking, concepts that are so really viciously, maliciously, wickedly attempting to, for the mind to deceive itself, trying to cast doubts upon God. And you experience that calmly. Just look, it arises, and you're practicing. I'm an apex yogin. Wow, I am an apex yogin. Wow. You experience it. You see it very clearly, and you say, "Wow, that's what's at play in this world." I mean, that so world, the world is under this horrible, like, spell. Actually, the mind's under this spell, terrible spell. Many, many, many spells we've cast upon ourselves. Actually, none of them have changed what we are in the slightest bit. Everything is still apex right now, directly right now. But these doubts reference themselves or other doubts and don't look at reality at all. And it's quite a trip to go through these different clever doubts that we try to cast upon ourselves and see it and experience it. When you experience it, it's a different story. Then you really have conviction, and you realize that the great Dharma kings have taught us correctly. They've pointed out correctly. And so I'm saying be neutral. Longchenpa appeared to me when he first came to me in a dream, as far as responding to a great plea for help here in the world. I said, "We're headed for bad trouble." He showed up. He had this lifeguard shirt on with this red cross on it. Well, guess what that red cross symbolizes? It symbolizes various things. It symbolizes the Red Cross, that agency, relief agency, which is good. But it also symbolizes Switzerland. Which is what? Switzerland stands for what? Neutrality. Neutrality. So Longchenpa is teaching us neutrality. Apex yoga is this wonderful neutrality. But the world is oblivious to this option because it's hell-bent on killing Jesus, so to speak, killing truth. And so what they're really doing is, I've always said that the two sides of one coin is a trap. They're trying to say you're either for this side or that side, and they're trying to polarize you into forgetting about the option of neutrality. And this is the great danger of these times. It's more and more and more you're going to find out you're being pressured to affirm what side are you on. But neutrality doesn't have any sides. Apex realization of reality. Reality doesn't have any sides to it. It's all right now. It's all right now. It's all apex in the now. And so when we insist on having sides, we're losing sight of the apexness of reality. And the perfect neutrality of the ground of being of reality. Where everything is equally arising in intrinsic spaciousness, the great sameness of it all, the great sameness. We're being conditioned to lose sight of this, which is the whole purpose of it all. So I've always said I'm independent, neutral. But people think, well, if you're not for us, you're against us. So you're just trying to trick us. We're really against us. So this, if you're not for me, you're against me, mindset of the world. I don't hear anywhere. Have I come across anyone saying, well, I'm actually neutral. I'm completely neutral. You don't hear that anywhere in the world now, do you? Everybody has a position. We don't have any position except the apex practice, which reveals there's no position at all, except everything is directly happening right now. It is directly happening right now. There's no intermediate step to any happeningness. Everything is perfect right now. All is perfect right now. There's nothing that needs to be fixed, except our bias against accepting this fact, right? That has to be evaporated. So we're in a very dangerous time. I'm getting heads up that something's going to happen. I did a big screen. I started a spring cleaning today. It just hit me so hard. God said, "Well, God blocked everything on the computer. I can't do anything. I want to do a bunch of graphics. I had all these ideas, and I can't do it. I can't do it." I said, "Wow, why God blocking me so severely?" And then God said, "Well, what about the room here? Have you got everything fixed up, ready to go somewhere?" And I said, "Nah, well, not really, no." And God says, "Well, why don't you deal with it now?" And I said, "Ah, it's too much work, God. I'll deal with it tomorrow." God says, "Okay, but what's wrong with right now? Is it too much work for you, or what's the problem?" I said, "Nah, I could do it pretty quickly, actually." Then God says, "Well, if you do it quickly, why not do it now?" It's like, huh? And I kind of said, "Well, you know what?" Suddenly it gripped me. You know, let's do it. Let's go for it. So I did. I just really started going real fast, doing stuff really, 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 really fast, and I put a big dent in it. You know, I really did a great amount of work, that stuff that I've been procrastinating on for years, thinking it's too difficult. I just did it super fast because somehow the motivation arose to do it. And I don't know what's going to happen, but I know the Lord is my pasture, my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd, so I shall not want. But exactly what's going to happen is still a mystery. It's still a mystery. I do know I'm working out now. It's really amazing. I found several. It's four. Oh, four different practices now, working out. And that's enough. That really worked great for what I want to do. It's amazing how it's all simplified. It's all simplified, and I'm able to do them. Before, I couldn't even think of doing this. It seemed like it was too difficult, but now I have this core strength that can handle it. It's about the core. If you have a really strong core, and you engage it in your exercises, you find you can really do some interesting exercises. So I'm just simulating the swinging of a golf club, but with heavy weights, and then with a super lightweight also for speed training, and then jogging on a trampoline. And this is all I'm really doing at this point. So everything has become very, very. You can do innumerable workouts of all different types, right? And yet, I've sort of just said, you know, let me just do this because I know this is going to help me. If I want to play golf, for instance, I know that these exercises are really going to build up, you know, key strength, really core strength that I need. So I just did those, and it felt great. I said, wow, this is really going to be helpful. Simple stuff, just like apex yoga. Simple, super simple practice, super simple practice. I feel that's all I need. I'm not trying to reach a whole bunch of attainments. Okay, it's not. I just want to get free of doubt, all right? Just get free of doubt and just rest in certainty. That's all. Now, I know that, for instance, Tibetan Buddhism, you know, it talks about all these attainments. There's a book here, Buddha Mind, that Longchenpa, an anthology of Longchenpa's writings, goes into, you know, he sort of goes over the history of Tibetan Buddhism and all these different practices. I mean, it just, it goes on and on and on and on and on. The elaborations are virtually endless, you know. But for me, I'm not interested in any of that. I'm not really not interested in all these attainments. Just the most simple one, okay? Just the most simple one. That's it. So this apex yoga has been suggested to me, and I'm loving it. It's quite amazing. I tried to do it all night last night, but I kept falling. I fell asleep, and I'd wake up, fell asleep, wake up. And then I woke up like 6, 7 o'clock in the morning and did it till like 10:30 in the morning, like 3 hours just straight. And that really revealed so much. Wow. Amazing, 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 amazing. Don't elaborate upon it. We're just coming to a stop at the bottom of this hill, like we're skiing down a icy slope, and we're breaking at the bottom of the hill. We're just coming to a stop in it. You know, coming. We're not trying to elaborate on anything. We're not aiming for attainments. We're not aiming for attainments. We're just doing the practice and trusting in it. Very, very simple. So, I'm loving simplicity at this time, and if there's a goal, like working out, you have a goal, then you start doing the exercises that you know are specific to that goal, and you know that's what's helpful. So we are really near to something. We're really near to something. Really, really near to just the way things are going. I'm feeling pretty good. I'm feeling pretty good all the way around, except the computer isn't working. I don't know what to do with my time, because I've spent a lot of my time working on trying to make beautiful stuff on the computer. A lot of time in my life, graphics, beautiful videos, beautiful this, beautiful that, just to try and help people move towards neutrality and say, you know what, why don't we just all meet on the level of sublime beauty, still calm, sublime beauty, and forget everything else, you know, and just be neutral about you know, the how do we kill truth, you know. The question of the world is how to. Now, I've gone through some pretty amazing experiences in this practice, apex practice. The second night, I lay down to bed to go to sleep. I said I'm going to practice, and the first thing that arose in my mind is the world spoke to me. It was like the world was suddenly spoke to me. I felt this. The world say, and the world says, "I love to kill. I love to kill." And I was just like, okay. I am an apex yogin. Wow, I am an apex yogin. Wow, so I just kept saying that, but I heard it very clearly. The word says, "I love to kill." And then I realized that's true, isn't it? So the world was just revealing itself to me. That's what it loves. It loves to kill, and we're all being killed by the world here. That's true, and then you know, then like last night. In the sporting, I saw stuff that, you know, could hardly even be talked about. It's so terrible, the truth of this world and what people are, what we're really doing here and trying to. But basically, I found out that people are trying to, the mind is trying to assassinate itself, actually. And all death is really assassination. As Jesus says, all death is suicide, but suicide is assassination, isn't it? And I found out that the reason why we die is because we're trying to assassinate God, essentially. And I saw that very clearly. I said, oh, okay, I am an apex yogin. Wow, I am an apex yogin, wow. And just, so whatever arises, you just keep doing with your practice. I am an apex yogin, wow. That's your boat. You're in this little boat, and you just stay in the boat. And all around you is this great ocean of confusion. Doesn't matter. You're in a boat. You're not in the ocean. I mean, just don't get out of the boat. Okay? Don't climb out of that boat. Just stay in the boat. So your practice is like this boat. And you say, I am an apex yogin. Wow. And you just keep affirming how great it is to be what you really are. I am an apex yogin. Wow. In other words, that's really great. I love this. So you just basically keep saying how much you love being what you truly are. And all the stuff that's casting doubt on what you truly are, you start to see it. You start to see it and say, oh, so that's one of the reasons why I was led astray. Oh, and there's another reason, and there's another. Oh, my gosh, I did that to myself. I cast this doubt upon. Oh, that's horror. That's nonsense. You know? And so you become aware of all the ways that we have tried to lead ourselves astray. So, the world is a nasty place, to say the least. The world of doubt is a very, very hellish place bent on death and assassination, actually. That's what it's really about. Trying to kill God. Trying to kill God in the name of God. I mean, Christianity is trying to kill God in the name of God. And the progressive liberals are trying to kill God in the name of no God. Yeah, but when you're neutral, you could see this. You could talk about it. Because I'm not interested in either one of those. I'm not interested in what style should we try to kill God in, you know? What style should we use? God can't be killed. So it's like, it's just all silly. It's all silly. But when we keep relating it, doubt relating to doubt, we stay in doubt. But when we just keep affirming how much we love what we really are, which is perfect certitude, without any doubt whatsoever, we get used to it. We get used to it. And of course, familiarity is decisive. The whole game is a game of familiarity, believe it or not. It is. We're just very familiar with all this doubt game. So we're biased against certainty. So you have to practice familiarity with certainty and say, I am an apex yogin. Wow. I love what I am. And this is, it may seem feeble, but it's actually quite strong because our love for what we are is so powerful. Even a little bit of practicing will bring us back to it. Will bring us back to it. And we'll get familiar, we'll feel a sense of familiarity, and then that will dispel. We'll just lose interest in doubt, doubting it. We just lose interest. We don't triumph over anything. Okay? We're not out to attain anything. We just lose interest in doubt. Because we rediscover our love for what we are, for reality, for certainty. We rediscover that, and we get used to it, and then we're just not interested in this stupid game of doubt anymore. It's that simple. So is that an attainment? Not really an attainment. It's just that we lose interest because we've gotten past this familiarity problem, which is so severe in everyone. That's all. Very simple. And it's pretty cold out here. It's going to be cold out here in the mornings for the next like 4 days or so. It's like 37-ish frost, I would imagine. But then the days are supposed to warm up, and actually going forward, it's supposed to be like 65 and night 44. It's even going to get up to 50 at night, and it's going to become quite mild. Going forward, maybe some late next week, and then going to the week after, and really spring is going to arrive with mild, warmer temperatures. So this is kind of like the last gasp of winter here. I think maybe the next four mornings will be rather chilly. I put all my warm weather stuff away, kind of most of it away today, and I said I'm headed for warmer climes now. I can just feel. You know, it's spring. Spring is what, basically like 3 weeks away right now. So it's time to get into that mood, the spring mood of whatever that may be, very spry for spring. And I'm feeling that way. I'm feeling better from the flu, feeling stronger, exercise, did a lot of exercise today. And just generally, in general, I feel pretty doggone good right now. And even in spite of all this practicing I'm doing, which is very, quite intense, and not sleeping so much, but I still feel really good. But this practice is not easy because you have to stay in the boat. That's the whole key to it. No matter what happens, you stay in the boat. If Jesus is walking on the water, you stay in the boat. It's positive, negative. What I saw is that the positive is used to try to lure you out of the boat of practice. And then once you're lured out of the boat of practice, then suddenly the negative arises and bites you. It's very tricky what we've done. Simple, simple stuff. You can see right through it. So you just stay in the boat of practice. I don't care what arises, whether something positive or enlightenment arises. Just say, well, I'm an apex yogin. Wow. Just stay at it. Just stay it. Stay there. Just get used to that. Oh, I'm an apex yogin. I am an apex yogin. Wow. That's awesome. That is really great. It's one who's getting familiar with the apex truth of reality. So I'm an apex yogin. I'm getting familiar with it. And that's all I'm doing. I'm not trying to attain anything else. I'm just getting familiar with it. So forget about all this positivity that arises. That's a trap. It's a trap. Soon as you leave the boat, doubts descend upon you and crush you. It's horrible, horrible. But if you stay in the boat, it's fine. Just stay in the boat. So it's that capability of just staying in the boat of practice, which is all important for success. So the qualities that one needs to be able to stay in the boat, of course, should be what our culture focuses on. We should all have be in agreement with this. It's easy. See, once you take the clues, cues from the Dharma kings, everything becomes smoothed out and simple and obvious, right? This it's not difficulty. We should just simply cultivate those qualities that help us stay in the boat. Because staying in the boat leads to successful familiarity with truth and a little loss of interest and doubt, and that's the end of it. Very simple. But that's we have to do it. So a Dharma King culture is the way to go. A Dharma King culture is the way to go. And the qualities of staying in the boat are the timeless traditional values of religion has brought. A lot of those are super helpful, super helpful, super helpful. Dispassion is very important. Detachment is very important. The patience, long suffering, forbearance, humility, forgiveness, meekness. It goes on and on. All the virtues, all that stuff's very, very, very important. You just be humble and meek and compassionate to yourself and forgiving, and you just stay in the boat and say, I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. And just stay in the boat of that. And again, if we don't stay in the boat, we're not going to get familiar with reality. And so we will continue to be simply lost in an ocean of labels, signifying nothing at all, actually, trying to figure out how to kill God. That's it. It's really all or nothing. It's one or the other. It's all the spiritual path is very much all or nothing, one or the other. Either we succeed or we fail. So we most certainly then have to use wisdom and say, wow, we better start cultivating these qualities that we need. Our culture needs to help us do that. And certainly hatred is not one of the qualities. Certainly this. Dion talked about how he, on drugs, how he was. It was amazing. He said, I was blaming everybody. I was scapegoating everybody. I was irritable. And I said, wait a minute, doesn't that sound like a lot of people these days? Well, he said that using drugs is the devil, because it shows up in your attitudes, and you become, you be turned into a scapegoat, scapegoating and blaming everybody else for your problems, and demonizing, the opposition. You become so angry and hostile and hateful. And Dion said that's how he was on drugs. And when God washed him clean, it was gone. It was gone. Yeah, he's a very mellow, beautiful man right now. It's just nice to see him. I just say, wow, there's a musician, that he's so unique in music. He is so unique that he's willing to speak up. It takes a real man to speak up about God, doesn't it? Especially in the entertainment industry. And Dion says most everybody I hang around with, man, they're just into the world and think that's winning and success and money and accumulations and all the that's where it's at. And he says, but they don't have peace of mind. He says, I have peace of mind. I have peace in my heart. I have peace in my heart. He says, I'm more creative now than I ever was before because the peace in my heart, God shows me this perspective, this beautiful creative perspective. And the thing is, he's like 77 and he's still singing great. He sounds great. I just listened to a video of him in December of 2016. He sounds fabulous. His voice is amazing. I said, wow, wow. But that's an anomaly, isn't it? It's pretty much an anomaly. But anyway, he was talking about how it is on drugs. And I noticed, I said, oh my gosh, that sounds like so many people today. A lot of the progressive liberals are that way because a lot of them use drugs. A lot of them use drugs. And the conservative people generally do not use drugs. They're not supposed to. It's a sin. And their attitude is different. It's different. It's different. It's mellower. You can tell. But those who have used drugs, you can pretty much tell those people who are soft on drugs, who use drugs, it leads to this attitude which gets very strident when things don't go their way. Very whiny, very strident, very hostile, very blaming, demonizing, scapegoating, all this kind of, toxic, very toxic. And that's exactly what Dion said he was like. Man, did that ring a bell when I heard that. And he says, you need God in your life. It's plain and simple. And the host asked him, do you have any advice for the world? He says, well, just two things. Have someone that you can talk with, talk it over with, and run it by them. A mentor, he says. You need a mentor. You need some kind of mentor. Some friend, some mentor. You can run things by them and get some feedback. And he says, don't go alone in life. So I have the Dharma Kings and the Holy Spirit for a mentor. And so I sort of do this mentoring, self-mentoring and such that I turn it over to them and I get answers back from them in my mind. And then he said, and you need God in your life. It's that simple. You need a mentor and you need God in your life. And that we said, that's my advice to everyone. And I said, wow, there's a wise man right there. A very wise man. Also showing himself to be one of the greatest singers the world's ever seen, really. I mean, at 77, he still sounds beautiful, and his phrase, beautiful. You need a spiritual mentor, and you need God. That's it. It's true. It's true. It's true. And we mean, by God, we mean the grace of God, the grace of God. And the grace of God moves you along the path so you keep evaporating your continuity fear. You keep evaporating your bias against certainty. Because this is, I'm not condemning the Christians and the liberals, but I'm saying they have severe bias against certainty. And that shows up in what they are trying to do. And here's someone trying to disrupt, man, I don't like that. I'm trying to disrupt my taping here. Well, maybe, yeah. Let's keep it short then. Let's keep it short here. And just say, okay, this is enough for now. Very, very simple, very simple. And I'll be in touch, hopefully, again, very soon. Okay, very great. That's it.